Hello and welcome to the Lharbur Show. My name is Luke Harbur. I am your host, and today I have the wonderful Tim Drake here. Tim, how are you doing?
I'm doing fantastic, Luke. Thank you.
You are very, very welcome. And I will let you guys know at the end of the show as to, you know, what the relationship is between Tim and I, because it's very special, but you'll have to watch after we get through the show. So, Tim, are you ready for the first segment of the show, Harbur Hot Takes?
Let's do it.
Wonderful. So, Tim here is going to get three topics that we're going to explore, but he only gets one sentence per topic to explain his opinion. So for example, if I were to say, Tim, what are your thoughts on religion? He would get one sentence and he would say,
Jesus is number one.
All right, there you go. Exactly. We've got three topics for him today. So let's get into the first one that someone submitted. So Tim, topic number one, what do you value most in life?
I would say God number one and family number two. And number three would have to be kind of what I do every day.
Beautiful. Okay. And topic number two, what are your talents and hobbies?
Talents and hobbies. I am the webmaster of the Central Midwest Hog Chapter based out of Olathe, Rawhide Harley-Davidson, and deal with their Facebook, Gmail, Facebook, the website, do anything I can do as a youngster and a group of older friends, and it's perfect. So it's a good time to enjoy the motorcycle culture and be a part of it and be able to serve it.
Amazing. Long sentence, but no, I heard all the semicolons and dashes. You did fantastic. Okay, and topic number three. In one sentence, what is life's purpose?
Life's purpose to me is doing something you love to do every day, having the people around you that you love, and having God in your life as well. Those would be those things.
Amazing. Way to go, man. Nice. And now for the second segment of the show, which is Harbur Talk. Tim and I are going to have three different taboo topics that we're going to explore within a 9-minute period. And we can talk about those topics as long as or as short as we want to. So does that sound good, Tim?
Yeah.
Okay. Are you ready to do this?
Let's do it.
All right. We are starting the timer in 3, 2, 1. So the first topic I want to explore with you today, Tim, actually comes from someone who follows this show. They really want us to talk about gun regulations. Now, in your opinion, why do you think that is a taboo topic for people?
Why do I think that's a taboo topic for people? I think that depends on the demographic of where we're at in the United States, whether whether you were brought up with guns, whether you were not brought up with guns.
Right.
I happened to grow up in a family where I was shooting .22 at like 5 years old, 6 years old, just target practice with my dad and brother and being able to do that kind of stuff. So to me, gun regulation, there shouldn't be any. I'm kind of more on the libertarian side of a lot of things, that you should have every freedom, that you should have the right to have. There should be as little regulation as possible. Now, I think it's an important conversation when we start to talk about mental health and we start to talk about all these other things.
Right.
My concern with that is that we have, in my opinion, pharmaceutical companies, we have all these companies that are harming us in a certain way that are causing mental illness type conditions, as well as the depression point of it with social media, with the feeling of acceptance with the younger generation. You know, you got kids nowadays that are committing suicide and all these other things just because they don't know how to cope with this environment that's so fast of the knowledge and information. And, you know, when I grew up, we didn't have cell phones that you had in your hand that you could access the information of the world.
Right. And it's intimidating in a way, right? In a way, it's coming at us so quickly. And in relation to guns, I think a lot of people in my generation see mass shootings that happen. When it comes to gun regulations, people see that, honestly, the gun crime and homicides that are happening in Kansas City, even, for example, sure. Right? Sure. When you take the guns out of the socioeconomic status or the background of somebody, I think it could kind of distort the narrative, and that can be harmful.
Right? Sure, sure. You know, unfortunately, it's just another tool. If someone's going to harm somebody, they're going to harm them, whether it's a knife, whether it's a, you know, a rock. I mean, we could use whatever tool you want to put in their person's hand, but at the end of the day, it's really the heart of the individual. And to me, we've kind of gone away from pointing us back to the individual. Who was the one that was at fault of doing this? Why are we blaming a mass a mass group of people for one individual's actions? And I think this is the only topics that happens with.
Right. And by mass group of people, are we talking about the NRA? Are we talking about gun advocates?
Just that whole topic.
Right. Okay. So people who affiliate with guns and are a part of that culture.
Sure. So you look at it and you go, you know, what are we really trying to do here? You know, we should be able to have our rights. We should be able to have our guns. Now, as far as what's going on with, the shootings and all those types of things in Kansas City, is that a horrible thing? Absolutely. Should we be trying to, you know, what was they had somebody shot the captain of the police force down here last year, I think.
Oh, I kind of remember that. I can't remember
you know,
the exact
was,
story.
Was murdered but out here. And it's like, you know, those are things where, I don't agree with that. But was most likely not a registered gun owner. And realistically, to even get a gun, you're going to go through a background check. You're not going to get the gun right away. You've got to have that background check happening. So, there's people want to take away the guns. Well, we got to get the guns off the streets. Well, the guns that are on the streets are the guns that deal, you know, they're not from people that willingly went out and bought the gun, went through the right steps to do what they needed to do.
Yeah.
These are stolen guns. These are, you know.
Well, and at least from what I understand, a lot of it can ultimately be someone's protection, right? I mean, I know for a lot of people who own guns, especially in poor socioeconomic status situations, that is your protection.
Yes.
I mean, statistically speaking,
you can call the cops, but the cops aren't going to be there for about 10 to 15 minutes.
Right.
And, you know, I think it was the police captain in Detroit, was on video basically saying, look, he goes, a lot of times we're there after, you know, you call us, but we're there after to help clean up after kind of what's happened. So, you know, that's where we have to look and we go, we have to take our safety, our personal freedom, and we have to make sure that we keep ourselves safe. Sure. You know, especially once I became a father, I looked at this and I said, this is even so much more important that I'm, you know, ready and I'm ready to take that threat if need to be.
You know, and honestly, I have not really thought of it that way. So thank you for sharing that. Let's go into the second topic of today, social media. And this is something that I really wanted to explore with you. So now, why do you think social media is a taboo topic for people to talk about?
I think for the older generations, they don't understand what it really is. I think when you had Facebook and Twitter and all these in front of, on live television getting grilled, the people that asked them the questions didn't really even know what to ask them. They're from a demographic. They're from, you know, they're all 60s, 70s. Are they on social media every day?
Oh, and you're talking about like Mark Zuckerberg being talked about by Congress and everything.
Absolutely.
Correct?
So, I mean, is the congressman?
Yeah, education.
Well, absolutely. So, they're asking them questions. You're just like, really?
You're
that's
like,
the
really?
Question we're going to ask them?
Yes.
I mean, come
this
on.
Is a very powerful individual, and that's what you're wondering about? Well, it just shows you then that there's so much that people don't know, and technology is moving so fast.
Correct.
And out of government.
So you look at the social media part of it. I've been part of social media for a long time. I was just, obviously with Facebook growing up, had that for a long time. There was a point in time in my life that I actually turned Facebook off, deleted the app. I was tired of it. I was tired of, you know, the negativity to some extent. But I think if a lot of people knew me, they would say, well, man, you're blasting all sorts of stuff on Facebook all the time.
Sure,
it's just,
yeah.
Questionable or, you know, maybe one-sided or, you know, whatever. My biggest thing is I want people to think and I want people to wake up.
Right.
You know, I'm a big, you know, Alex Jones supporter. Been a supporter for him since about 2012. He knows what's going on. He may be a little bit off on the right a little bit as far as the way he thinks, but really his concern is, hey, look, I want all my liberties. You know, this is America. There shouldn't be any restrictions on the liberties that we should be able to have. And part of that, in 2016, with the election of Trump and Hillary, you know, that whole debacle, in my opinion, of what that really became, there was so much silence for him before that election, where they basically took him off social media and banned him from it. He still has a website, still has daily show every day, millions of subscribers, millions of people listen to him every day. I'm one of those people that most of the time I'll tune in maybe once a day and absolutely listen to kind of what's going on and his take on what's going on in current politics and current events and all these things. And it's just sad to see that we have CEOs of companies that want to silence certain things or being persuaded by outward interests that want to silence interests within the United States, that I think a majority of people in the United States have the same feelings.
Right. Well, and at least when I think of Alex Jones, at least just from my perspective, I've seen a lot of out of context clips of him. Sure. I can't say I've really sat down.
Makes the frogs gay.
Well, right. And I, you know, and I've seen him, like, you know, pound like desks and get really angry and mad. And he'd call Hillary a lot of things that I didn't agree with. But again, those are highlighted clips of him.
Sure.
Right? I haven't seen him. I don't know him on a day-to-day basis. I don't know what he's like when he's eating breakfast in the morning. He expresses certain anger and certain things that I don't agree with. And I think social media can be a very fine line for people like him, and even people who are left, if we're, let's just call it out, of course.
The Young Turks.
Right. Honestly, yes, definitely the Young Turks. It's questioning whether or not they're inciting some kind of violence or hate speech. And I think I struggle with that. I sometimes just wonder, what does that mean and what does that really look like? But I'm not saying it's a good thing or a bad thing.
Absolutely.
It's just important to ask those questions.
So what you want to look at is when you go, hey, we look at these clips of Jones where he was on Joe Rogan's show and, you know, he just got fired up and he's, you know, and that's really where you look at that. That's the passion he has for what is really going on, and the fact that the mainstream media doesn't report the right answer.
Right.
And I think that's where you have to have an objective. You have to look at these things for yourself. You have to look at them in context of what happened. You know, what really happened here? You have to become with your own conclusion on these events, because we're lied to, in my opinion, from the mainstream media.
A lot about of media that stuff. Lies, a lot. Yes.
So, you know, and to me, it's sad that we're in almost 2020. We have, you know, realistically, journalism died under Obama, in my opinion.
Sure, sure.
There was a lot of journalism that basically, hey, it's hush, or you're pushing this narrative, when you can watch 30 news stations and they all are projecting the exact same message.
Right. It can be very disassociating.
We're not thinking for ourselves anymore.
No, it's hard to look at things as pure facts nowadays. And just what are your, because I know the timer went off, but it's all good. It always happens. what are your final thoughts on actually what you wanted to talk about today? And we touched on it a little bit with social media, but freedom of speech. So what are your kind of final parting thoughts with that particular topic?
You know, with as far as freedom of speech goes, there's a lot of it's the most important thing we can have. And if we're going to start to silence people over the speech, because kind of like what we talked about before, I mean, just the fact that we're able to communicate and we are totally, you know, kind of an opposite ends of the spectrum as far as political, I would assume, affiliation, you know, we have to be able to have those communication lines have to be open. You have to be willing to have a conversation with someone else that doesn't agree with what you agree with. And you're going to come to an agreement, I would assume, somewhere with that person where you both agree with the same thing. You just may still agree with different, different venues.
Act like very, okay, let me breathe here. We have certain agreements that may be few, but at the end of the day, we have a shared humanity.
Absolutely.
Although we have a lot of disagreements. Absolutely. We're living life together.
Absolutely.
But, Tim, you were nothing but a joy and a pleasure. Thank you, my very good sir. Absolutely, that was awesome. Sir. Thank you all so much for watching today. And Tim, thank you so much for being on the show.
It's been awesome, my friend. We've been wanted to come on ever since you started your show. So I'm just glad to support you.
Oh, you're the best. And to give you a little reveal as to who Tim is to me, I had a liver transplant when I was 11 months old. And Tim's brother, Aaron Drake, unfortunately, he passed away when he was 8 years old. But I received his liver. And that is why I am the way I am.
Yes.
There's
yes.
something special about a second chance at life and still being appreciative of someone like you.
Well, it's just awesome to see you grow up and knowing you from a little boy.
You know me as a little bean, man.
To grow up and finish high school and college and do what you want to do in life. And nothing happier to see that. So.
Well, I love you and appreciate you, man.
Love you, bro.
You're the best. Get over here. All right. Well, hey, are you ready to do the end slate together?
Let's do it.
Okay. Here we go.
Pause, play,
be kind, and make a difference. We'll see you guys soon. Ready? We're getting down the couch. Go to the couch. I'm following you. Give me some dance moves. What do we got?
Oh, I got nothing.
I got it. Okay, how about a little like?
Screw that guy, the dance.
Left, right,
left. The guy that sends him back just like, yeah.
Yeah, down to the beat.